Sportjournaal. Boks. In 'n wêreld lig swaargewig titelgeveg dag Suid-Afrika se peervoorie die kragtige Bob Foster in Albuquerque uit. Hoor na Gerard Wivier.
En dat is goeie van Aanpien om Larry Fitzgerald die palen met prik. Foster is duidelijk moe. En voor hier is bezig aan die dag beweegt. Foster is zeker recht uit linker uit. Die probeert met de weer met de recht uit linker. Maar is die handschoenen pas. En voor hier wat niet veel schoenen in die ronde gepland. Dat is die einde van die gepland. En jou werkelijk waar, die eerste lichtzwaargewicht, die tweede lichtzwaargewicht van die 15 ronde in Bob Foster weg. En Foster, hoe hatig hij ook al vanmorgen was, die val voor Fourie om die lijf van Fourie nader kom om geluk te wijzen te bedanken voor een mooie gevecht.
Fourie hou Suid-Afrikaanse naam hoog, maar Foster behou sy titel.
Victor Galindez of the Argentine, the World Boxing Association's World Light Heavyweight Champion, defending his title for the first time, and we're ready for the start of round one. Tonight he takes on Fourie Fourie of South Africa with Alan Tawil, his manager and trainer behind him. A man 5 years older, the fight is on. Fourie, more experienced, trying for the third time to win this light heavyweight crown. Also trying to become the third South African to win a world title. The others, of course, being Vicky Tawil and Arnold Taylor. A beautiful evening here at Ellis Park. Crowd not the least bit discouraged by the postponement from Saturday evening, and I think they're pleased to be short of a dry seat, which they do have, and a milder, clearer atmosphere. The stars are shining. Will they shine this evening for this South African challenger? In the blue shorts, the defending world champion, Victor Galindez, in the shining white shorts. A cautious start by both boxers, although that left hook from Galindez meant business. It didn't land. They're both probing tentatively, as so often happens in a big fight like this. They're prodding and they're pushing. They're watching each other very, very carefully. People expecting an early assault from Galindez, because there is a feeling that if Fourie can get round the corner and survive the first six rounds in this fight, he could go on to win on points. But at the moment, it's Fourie who's making most of the openings. He's the one who's leaning forward, taking the fight to his opponent, and controlling it just a little from the center of the ring. Halfway through round one, and there are 15 rounds in all. First clinch of the fight, and Mr. Schmidt is very quickly in to separate the two boxers. Galindez conserving energy. Notice how solid he is there. Flurry which the crowd enjoyed there, but certainly no damage inflicted at all. Galindez, one feels very conscious of Fourie's fitness, his powers of endurance, and his speed, which we're seeing something of already. In goes Fourie again, and Fourie's elusiveness too, when necessary. But for both fighters, after only 2 minutes and 10 seconds of the first round, there's a very long way to go. Fourie using that left jab, and a left from Galindez as well, just to show that he can give as much as he's going to take this evening. For Fourie, the left jab could well be the main scoring weapon in the early rounds of the fight. 30 seconds to go in round one. Judges this evening, Stan Christodoulou of South Africa, Tim Kelleher of the United States. He's from Albuquerque. He judged in the second Foster Fourie fight in Johannesburg. And Pedro Galea from the Argentine. Nose closing in every sense. Neither fighter is marked. Alan Tawil in the white, attending to the South African challenger, simply working on the perspiration. And Galindez ready for action at the start of round four. Tends to stay on his feet as much as he can. Waldemar Schmidt calls him out for action at the start of this round. And taking the center spot is the world champion, Victor Galindez from the Argentine. Once again, it's probably going to be the speed of foot, hand and eye of Fourie against the tremendous power of Victor Galindez. Son of a farm labourer, one of 8 children, he's probably known what it is to have a rough time throughout his life. Tough brawler, they say, from the back streets of Buenos Aires. And there you can see some of the exchanges both men sliding in. A bit of in-fighting. Short-range body blows. Galindis takes the fight forward now. No damage done. Again, no tense from that assault by Galindis. What a fight this is. This is Fury at his best, using his experience to good advantage, preventing Galindis so far from really unleashing an effective two-fisted assault. Now Fury's going to have to work to keep out of trouble, because Galindis certainly does mean business in round four. We've seen it already. Fury in front, and Galindis looking as though he wants the action. Waldemar Schmidt, the referee, handling the fight with the greatest professional skill imaginable. You'll notice how he keeps out of range, but he's allowing the fights to flow. In he goes, taps the fighters, and they break. Cleanly and decisively. Very little interruption from the referee. This is world-class experience, and he's certainly showing what he's made of. Fighters close in again. Nothing good landed. Fury using that left most effectively now. You know, notice how straight it is. And it's on target. Through the defense there with the left. But Galindis can take it. And he's remaining very calm. Lots of fainting from Galindis there. But a firm stance in the center of the ring. And Fury got in there with a little left and the right cross. 30 seconds to go in round four. Those snappy left jabs from Fury. 52 fights. Only 4 knockouts, Fury. And Galindis, 46 fights. And 25 knockouts. Fury stopped that attack most effectively before it could lead to anything uncomfortable. And I would say another round to Fury. That was round four. His lead could well be 2 points at this stage. Fury landed his 2 best punches in the first minute. And Galindis, as you saw there, planted a good hook just before the bell. But Fury edging in front slightly, as we thought he might, out of sheer boxing skill. Galindis refusing to sit down. Fury quite happy to have a little demonstration from Alan Jawil, with Tony Farrar leaning concernedly through the ropes, and Jimmy Jawil rendering what aid is needed to the challenger from through the ropes. Only one man, of course, allowed in the ring, and that is Alan. The evenness of height making all the difference. In so many ways, this time, Fury is on level terms, and he's not letting Galindis capitalize on that 1.5 kilo weight advantage. We're ready now for round five. Mr. Schmidt is there in the center, and the fight is on. Perspiration wiped simply off Galindis's face there by the referee. And it's all the action now in round five, with the South African in front, and this vast crowd of perhaps 35,000 people lending all the support. And he's gone into fighting southpaw. Yes, you'll notice that. Fury has the ability to chop and change, and he's doing it to unbalance his opponent a little, to start at round five, disturb his rhythm if he can. Now he's back to the conventional, leading with his left. Just for a few moments at the start of this round, Fury came out southpaw. But you'll notice the footwork. He's ready to try and deceive his opponent and just leave him uncertain as to how he's going to do it. And I think he's settled down again now after 1 minute in round five. Fury staying in forward gear and counter-punching there from Galindis, most effective, going slightly backwards but landing out pretty hard, keeping out of trouble and fighting even as he backpedals. Galindis certainly knows how to use the ropes effectively. He's never been afraid of being sacked against them. But it's Fury who's showing all the confidence. Galindis going in and not achieving anything at all there. Fury never so far.
loved every movement there as he came in. See the calmness, the control in his face. For he is certainly in charge in these early rounds. And he's got comfortably to round five, and a useful lead has been built up. Galindas must be very concerned at the elusiveness of his challenger. I don't think he expected to have to work quite so hard to come to close quarters. Notice how quickly and effectively they broke on the referee's instructions. 45 seconds to go in round five of a scheduled 15-round fight. Galindas can't reach his opponent. And Lee is not backhanding. He's watching and watching. Fighters extremely fit and very conscious that they must be prepared to go all 15 rounds if necessary. 10 seconds to go. A very effective piston left there from Galindas. Those didn't land for Lee out of trouble. The end of round five, and that southpaw start by Lee didn't bring obvious results. But I think he's got another round, and if so, that would mean a three-point lead. There were two stunning hooks from Lee in that round. We've not often seen him hit harder than that, and his defense is still good, and that does bring in the points. It's worth remembering. I like the way he slipped inside some of the champion's assaults there, and that's why the round must be his. An absorbing contest in every way. Again, nothing but perspiration being mopped from his brow. Attention again from Black Touré on the world champion. Skill against power, an absorbing contest. Age against youth, 5 years difference. Youth, of course, Galindas' way. A huge crowd. A fight that looks as though it might well go the full distance. The South African in front, but both men supremely fit and equally capable of winning. We're ready now for round six. The anticipation still tremendous. All the tension of the box has come out again. So many unpredictables in the air. A wonderful night for boxing, a true sporting contest, well controlled and green so far. And the assault coming from the silver shorts of Victor Galindas from the Argentine, softening up his opponent. One third of the distance gone. Both fighters still unmarked, believe fighting the fight of his life and still in control. Face as he comes. It must be infuriating to see a man stay so calm even under pressure. Galindas in his first title defense, defense of his world title, perhaps a bit surprised at the toughness of the opposition. 1 minute gone, round six, and still no real drama. A fight for the connoisseur, not for the spectator who's looking for blood. They might well not get it this evening. Push and prod him onto the ropes. It's a great tactical struggle, as you notice, as good as we've seen in years in South Africa. And this is the way it often is in the tense circumstances of a world title fight. It's not necessarily the heavy blows that get through, it's the tactics. There's just too much at stake. Both men are so concerned to watch their opponent. Galindas looks more business like. McCree is still scoring. 1 minute to go in round six. McCree still in the lead. You notice how McCree saw punishment there and still came into the post. Now out of trouble, darting away, ducking beautifully there. 30 seconds to go. That left McCree just missed doing well. He's landed in the target area at the end of the round six, and that could still have been Kareem Brown at a lead that is more secure. There were times there when Galindez looked very dangerous. There were some damaging blows delivered by him, but Fareed rode the storm well, and if he can continue to ride the storm and hang on to his lead, the champion could well yet be seriously worried. Fareed, as you notice, still moving well. That's the important point. He's scoring in defense, and he's fit enough and tough enough to take a lot of punishment. Again, we saw that in round six. Whether it's sapping his energy or not, we'll soon see, but he's not yet showing signs of weariness, nor is the world champion, as you can see there. Perspiration pouring down his face. Now we take a close look at Fareed, who's not troubled. Unmarked. The crowd, extremely well behaved, appreciating the tenseness of the struggle.
Maar as Gerrie vir Spinksie pak gee, sal die bek soos ons daai heinkie soen. I'm Spinks the Vampire, met disco op die rug. Ach, please Muhammad Ali, gee my voortanne terug. But watch it, old Gary, die teken was daar. Toe spiekeries in my batu, my majonteid verwar. Toe spiekeries in my batu, my majonteid verwar. Gary Sjereinkies Koesie, is die naam wat ook al jou noem. Maar as Gary vir Spinksie pak gee, sal die bek soos ons die heim. Alles ver in Monaco, dis laat in die nacht. Ons het voor die radio Suid-Afrika wacht. Op oorwinning vir Gerry, Tamuisie en oom Flip. Die jengslik sy pille, Gerry te kom toch dik. Die jengslik sy pille, Gerry te kom toch dik. Gerry sy reinkies koesie, is die naam wat ook al jou noem. Maar as Gerry vir Spinksie pak gee, sal die bek soos ons die hein. Gerry sy reinkies koesie, is die naam wat ook al jou noem. Maar as Gerry vir Spinksie pak gee, sal die bek soos ons die hein.
Thank you very much, Larry Merchant, and there are champions all around the Riviera here, former convention center, surrounded by heavyweight champions. I've got two of them surrounding me right now. The WBA heavyweight champion, Jerry Coetzee, and the IBF heavyweight champion, Larry Holmes. And they, of course, are going to have a fight upcoming. We're going to talk about that in just a moment. But first of all, let me get your impressions of the fight that we just saw. We have a new champion in boxing. That's what we need, another heavyweight champion, Larry Holmes. But it was a very good fight.
Yes, I agree with you. Barry, it was a very good fight, but again, they had a championship fight without the champion. I'm the champion, and I think the world know it. These guys keep fighting each other, and the title keep changing hands. I had the title 6 years, reigning heavyweight, undisputed heavyweight champion of the world.
All right, eventually this will all get settled for sure. Jerry Coetzee, the WBA champion, let me ask you, before we talk about you two guys, let's talk about what we saw tonight.
Well, I expected Thomas to beat Witherspoon, and I don't think this is good news for Larry, because Larry had a tough call with Tim Witherspoon, and Pinklin Thomas made real easy work of him, and I fought a draw with Pinklin Thomas, I fought a draw. So if I'm Larry, I'll think twice about my upcoming fight.
The kid does have a very effective left jab. We've always talked about your left jab. We saw a pretty good one tonight.
Yes, Pinker have a good left jab, but if I were box thinking Pinker Thomas, I would use Stumbling's glove. But nor less, you know, Jerry is making a lot of statements. I'm not worrying about Jerry. All he had to do is sign the contract. I had done it all. I gave money up. I put money up. I postponed dates. I postponed my retirement. I done it all, Barry. And hey, just to prove to the people, I'm it. I'm the man. I'm the heavyweight champion of the world. Not Jerry Cosell, not Pinkerton Thomas, but me, Larry Holmes, the undisputed reigning heavyweight champion of the world. The world knows it. Let the world be the judge of this, Barry. I don't got to tell you this because you know it.
All right, Jerry Cosell. Now, this man says we have to sign a contract. Now, we had heard there was a contract signed. Are we going to see Jerry Cosell fight Larry Holmes?
We're definitely going to see this fight coming off. And Larry Holmes is quite right, but he's been calling the shots as well. And, you know, Larry Holmes is living with a dream. And that dream is not going to continue.
All my dreams come true, Larry. All of my dreams come true, because if it went, I wouldn't have been a heavyweight champion for 6 years. And as soon as this chump here put his name on the contract, I'm going to knock him out. And when the judge makes his final decision next week, and then I'll be able to go forward with this fight. But all he got to do is come on, stay the hell out of South Africa, and come on right here and prove to me that he's the heavyweight champ. Don't worry about the dreams. My dreams come true. And when I knock you out, it'll be my other dream come true. And then I might let all of y'all have it. Because I'm bad. Everybody know it. Am I bad, y'all?